Happy New Year! Whoa.
And today we're going to use this occasion to travel the world and explore new global ingredients, or new to us. Boys, number one, lift the cloche.
Mushrooms?
Close.
It's got a spinachy look to it. It's got the ironiness of spinach.
It has, okay. But it's got the texture of mushrooms.
Mushrooms, yeah. I also feel like there's some kind of raisiny sultana element in there as well.
Like a dried or a fruit, quite sweet.
Yeah.
So
it's glossy.
Glossy is a good description.
Mm. It is described as being quite sweet, but at the same time, very savory and kind of earthy. Have you ever seen anything like it before? Have you any idea where in the world it might have come from or what it might be?
They don't have the same bite as a mushroom. So they're almost a little bit more watery when you bite into them, and they sort of just disintegrate, whereas a mushroom has a little bit more purchase on them. Taste-wise, they're nice. They are unusual. I haven't tasted anything like them before. They're like a merging of lots of different things all into one.
I imagine it's a filling to something.
So this is smut. Corn smut. Otherwise, it might go by the name in a kind of rebranding exercise as Mexican truffle.
Oh.
Or huitlacoche, which would be its kind of traditional name. And there's lots of theories on where the name came from and what it means, but one of them is raven droppings.
Oh, it's not getting better, is it?
No, it's not.
Have I sold it to you so far?
Smutty raven droppings.
Droppings, yeah. Happy New Year.
What it is it's a fungus that grows on corn.
Interesting.
Now, as it grows on the corn, it kind of retards the growth of the corn plant itself, so you get a lower yield of corn. The corn is still edible, but you just get a lot less of it. But you then do get this, which is used in all sorts of places in Mexican cuisine and is trying to be introduced as perhaps a high-end, almost Mexican truffle kind of vibe. Another name for it, Aztec caviar.
Interesting.
The power of rebranding.
Upcycling.
Yeah, like absolutely. Yeah, yeah. Can we try it in a dish?
Absolutely.
Yes.
Yes.
Holy guacamole.
A filling inside of a quesadilla that uses this. It's also got some onions, some pork, obviously some cheese in it, a little bit of hot sauce. Enjoy.
Oh, wow.
Mmm. That works perfectly with cheese.
Oh, they're fantastic hot. Yeah. It makes it, I mean, they are cold.
Yeah.
But when they are warmed through, this is stunning.
So other uses, it might be stirred through soups or stews. Sometimes it is used to give real depth to a dish like succotash.
Definitely
succotash,
does.
Yeah. Which is like corn and beans in a wonderful sort of side dish, stewy thing. But here, a classic filling for quesadilla.
It's a delicious meaty spinach mushroom.
It's exactly what it
that
is.
That is exactly what it is. And it's fantastic.
Did you bring this back from
Of course he did.
No, so this would be quite seasonal in the sense that when it's fresh and growing on the corn, it'll be during the rainy season of Mexico. So we're talking sort of April through to September-ish, which means it wasn't in season fresh when I was there. However, we've obviously bought a tinned version and it's a way of preserving that fresh ingredient all year round. So no, I didn't bring it back. This was sourced in London from a Mexican grocer. What do we think?
I think that's one of the best quesadillas I've ever had. For me, anywhere where mushrooms go, that would go. And you'd get a slightly different profile, which would just add something to the dish.
Do you think there's a chance that we've had this before in a dish in a Mexican restaurant, but just not necessarily known it?
Very possibly, and that would give you that really kind of authentic flavour. You just can't quite pinpoint what it is.
Yeah.
And I think, I mean, that particular tin, they're stored in oil, which has got a little bit of jalapeno pepper and salt through it as well, so they're already kind of seasoned. But it's one of those ingredients that I think, even as normals, whilst this is an excuse to explore global ingredients we've not heard of and just be globally curious, I think this is a really easy one that we could incorporate in our home cooking. I think what's really interesting about this is it's a natural fungus that sometimes grows on corn and it's a bit of a pain because it reduces the yield of the corn. But now, because this is gaining popularity, especially in high-end restaurants, Michelin-star restaurants, there are some farmers who are deliberately inoculating their crop to destroy or certainly make the corn suffer, but knowing that this has a higher price at market than perhaps the corn would have done, even if it did better. It's a really interesting thing because it has to grow on corn. It takes the sweetness from the corn, which is when you said it was quite sweet, and therefore I think super fascinating.
It's such a weird dynamic, isn't it, when the demand outstrips supply, so producers find other ways to grow it, and it's always you always feel a little bit edgy about that kind of...
Well, it started as a pest, but it's been really cleverly utilised because it tastes so good to not be a pest and to be used as a byproduct. But now the byproduct's more valuable than the original thing that they're trying to grow.
But it's only once it's rebranded as Mexican truffle or Aztec caviar, because corn smut isn't necessarily going to do it. Do you want to try another one?
Yeah.
Yes, please.
I'm in.
If you're enjoying this, there are some small things you can do that make a big difference to us. Like the video, subscribe if you aren't, click the notification bell and select all. Thanks.
Lift the cloche on number two.
I shall.
Oh, where in the world are we now?
Popcorn-y vibes, but it's a bit more puffed and...
Puffed, yes. Corn, no.
They look like the little polystyrene balls they put in packaging to stop it getting damaged.
Yeah.
It tastes like, it's got the texture of a Wotsit that's been left out of the packet for a few hours.
A slightly stale puffed snack.
Yeah.
They're exactly as expected in that you bite into them, they're crispy, and then as soon as, you know, the saliva gets to them, they just sort of go all soggy.
Once moisture is added back in. Any idea what they are? I'd be amazed if you guess it.
Puff
it's
couscous.
Whether you already know it.
No, I can't tell you what grain or something it is.
Is it a grain? Is it a legume?
So I think it is something that we have done before in a food trend episode in little snack format. But interestingly enough, we're not talking about, you know, new emerging food trends here. We're talking about something that is eaten and consumed already by about 1 billion people.
Wow.
In places like India, Pakistan. They are fox nuts or puffed lotus seeds or lotus kernels.
Oh, wow. Mm. I don't even know what a lotus kernel looks like.
What I find fascinating about these is how they are grown and harvested. So lotus flowers grow on top of water, bogs, marshes, ponds, lakes, and they send out all their thorny little leaves on top of the water. And then when they flower, the seeds pop off and they basically go into the water and they sink to the bottom. So you literally dredge the bottom of the water to get them, which means they're also covered in mud and all the other things you'd find at the bottom
fish
of
poo.
A, probably fish poo.
Shopping trolleys.
Maybe shopping trolleys. And then they have to be cleaned. So there's a thorough cleaning process, at which point they're then sun-dried and stored and later puffed to end up like that. They're called Paul McCana.
It's one of the Beatles, isn't it?
They're called Paul McCana. No, just not a Beatle.
Right. Oh no, he's the hypnotist guy.
McKenna. They're called Paul McCana, fox nuts or puffed lotus seeds or kernels.
They do have that sort of legumey aftertaste.
I thought tea, actually. They reminded me of the dryness of tea.
The tannin, kind of bitterness tannin.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
And interestingly, if you just popped a corn kernel, you know, plain popcorn is also quite plain, but you can, of course, flavour them. Would you like some flavoured ones?
Yes, we
please.
Would. Fantastic. Smells spiced.
Pop a couple of those fox nuts in your mouth.
Oh my goodness, they're so much better.
Essentially, the ones you had straight out of the bag, I think they've still got a little bit of moisture in them, which is why when you chew them, they go kind of
they have some spice
chewy on
them.
Your teeth. But actually these, once you've toast them in a dry pan for a little while, they go even crunchier and puffier, and they become an absolute delicious
snack.
They are
so Moorish. You could eat the whole plate of those.
When you think about them nutritionally, they are perfect in a plant-based diet, which obviously we're seeing a lot more of. They're gluten-free as a snack, you know, like popcorn is as well. But for that reason, and the fact that this global curiosity is like expanding the world and we're all really interested in cuisines from elsewhere, they're becoming more popular than ever. There's some lotus nuts.
They're like mini olives.
In syrup that haven't been puffed, but essentially you've taken out the moisture and replaced it with air. So you sort of sun dry it or dehydrate it and then they puff it.
Oh, they're far more legumey in this form. Mm. You can eat them just like that, like they are good.
So obviously the lotus flower has lots of symbolization all over sort of Southeast Asia, but when we're talking about the puffed version, really big in India and Pakistan, whereas the sweeter version in the syrup in the tin, more kind of Chinese.
Ah, gotcha.
How have I never seen this before?
Yeah.
I've never come across it.
The toasted version of the puffed ones, the texture, the crunch is fantastic.
Yeah, really Moorish.
You could use that in cooking. Like, you could top a dish.
You could use that in cooking.
But instead of just a snack form, you could actually use it to add texture to a dish.
Yeah.
Is what I'm saying.
So, thumbs up again?
Yeah, definitely. Brand new, never seen anything like that.
That's great. I'm sure there are tons of people in the comments shouting at us right now, telling us how best to use them and what flavours to add to them and that kind of thing.
I will be reading those shoutings because these are great.
Much like the versatility of popcorn, you could do a whole host of things with them.
Yeah.
Would you like to see another ingredient?
Yes, please. This one's yours, big boy.
Thank you.
A leaf.
It looks like a big shiso leaf.
Yeah. Oh dear. Wow.
Straight off, I'm very impressed at how easily you picked that up with chopsticks.
Well done.
They're quite difficult things to pick up. Jamie was pretty close, actually. Shiso leaf.
Cheers. Cheers. Oh, a lot sweeter and spicier than I expected.
I did not expect that much flavour.
Obviously, it's very vegetal in terms of texture. But it's really satisfying, actually.
I prefer the initial taste than the aftertaste.
Yeah, it leaves you, it tastes green at the end, doesn't it?
Leaves you with green.
Yeah, it leaves you with green.
And I think perhaps the reason for that is these have come in a tin, so they have been through the canning process, as opposed to freshly cooked, steamed, and served in a similar way. This particular one is a Korean dish, although perilla leaves, or shiso, or sesame leaves, depending on which country you're in. Are big in Southeast Asia.
Great, so which ones are these?
Depends on whether you read the front or the back of the tin. Oh, on the front of the tin, it says perilla leaves. On the back of the tin, it says sesame leaves.
Sesame leaves.
In soy sauce.
Are these in soy sauce?
I think they have some soy in there with some oil, there's a little bit of vinegar, there's some capsicum, so
bloody
chili.
Bloody spice in it, I'll tell you that
capsicum.
Much.
Our understanding is that it also comes by the name rice gobbler. It makes rice disappear.
That's on your Wikipedia page, isn't it?
Yeah, but that's in risotto form. Well, let's put it into practice.
Hello!
Ah, yeah. So what we've got for you is some nice steamed rice and some seared ribeye with sesame. And I think if you put a little bit of the steak on top of the rice and then lay one of the perilla leaves over the top and then basically pick the whole thing up with your chopsticks, almost like Pac-Man, the leaf kind of just gobbles up the rice and you put the whole thing in.
Steak on rice, leaf on steak. Yeah, over the top.
Rice gobbler. Now the fresh perilla leaves, it's part of the mint family. It's said to kind of have a flavour that's somewhere between kind of mint and basil. Sometimes it's used to make delicious tea. Sometimes it's shredded and put through dishes. Sometimes dishes are served on top of them. And in this instance, they're already cooked in all of that sort of chili and soy and extra garlic and red pepper paste. And you use that to mop up or gobble up the rice.
I really like it. I think it really adds something to the steak and the rice. It adds a lot more than I thought it was going to add to it.
Yeah, I'm thinking like if you would generally use spinach or something like that.
Yeah,
this is like another level because it's got a very different texture.
And places like Vietnam, there's a version of a perilla leaf that would be sort of put into bundles of herbs to go into things like your pho, when you have that mountain of fresh herbs. In Japan, we had them quite a bit with sushi as a fresh shiso leaf. Mm-hmm. They can also be tempura'd, which is delicious. And there is a slight confusion, and it's more of a language thing in Korea where sesame leaf and perilla leaf are kind of given the same name. Fun little story.
Hey, Jamie.
Last year, I was on dating TikTok, and there was a big debate that kind of went viral all about these leaves.
What?
She was in a restaurant with her boyfriend and one of her besties, and they were chatting through dinner, and her boyfriend noticed that her best friend was struggling to pick up the leaves with the chopsticks. So he reached over with his chopsticks, helped her out and put it onto her plate.
You're not allowed to
do that. She was just saying, is that all right?
You don't
to use your own personal chopsticks to help in the first place.
Because they've been in your mouth.
To show sharing of food. And it became an absolutely viral thing because everyone was debating where the lines and boundaries of meeting with new people perhaps you've met for the first time, when is it acceptable to try and help and how do you help, and is picking up a perilla leaf with your chopsticks and putting it on your girlfriend's bestie's plate acceptable?
Wow, people have too much time.
They do. But I'm hearing, don't put your chopstick on your girlfriend's best friend.
Don't.
Some people are saying exactly that.
It's symbolic.
Maybe the sharing of food in Korea is a sign of love. And perhaps he stepped out of line, whereas a lot of people are saying he was just trying to help out and you'd want someone to try and help out if you were struggling.
We don't have those kind of restrictions here.
There have been no boundaries. Any boundaries that were once there have been erased.
So perilla leaves, not cheap in the UK in their fresh form because they're few and far between and quite a specialist ingredient. But something like this as a tin, can you see yourself using it in any way?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
A midweek dinner like that, sear a steak, cook off some rice and away you go. Like, so easy. Open a tin, job done.
It's so easy because it's just straight out of a tin. It is that easy.
I'm not quite au fait enough with them to probably use them at home, I'll be honest, because I just don't know what else. Yeah, but then what else do I do with them except for this?
Oh, that looks great. Do that once a month. Oh.
Yeah. But I like it. I'm really glad I tried it. It's probably one more that I'd like to experiment with, but through some form of cooking here.
The safety of the studio.
Yeah, more so than taking it straight home.
Or I'd order it in a restaurant.
I definitely, if I saw it in a restaurant, 100% order it. Definitely.
And that is why we are so lucky with what we do, constantly exploring new ingredients. But if it's food inspiration you're after, check out Sidekick. It's also free for 30 days.
Are we ready?
Ready?
Last one. It's very good. Looks
it's
good.
It's a drink. It's a cold drink.
Cheers.
Cheers.
One of the
what
most
does that smell like?
Refreshing things.
That smells really familiar. Oh, that smells spiced. It smells like turmeric.
Nearly, not quite.
It's fizzy. Well, it has a fizz. It's not like carbonated, but it's got a fizz.
Oh,
is that a natural fizz? Is it like it's a bit beetrooty.
No.
No, it's a spice.
Yeah, Mike's on the right line. Which spice is it?
Cumin.
Yeah.
That's cumin. Look at me.
What you're drinking is a cumin soda, or jeera, as it would be in India. So it's a lemon-based drink or soda that then has salt, sugar, obviously sodas are sweet, and cumin. I remember first having this from a vendor on the streets in India, and it, in the hot and heat of India, it was just the most refreshing because it is that salt and sweet which your body just craves because you've been sweating loads. It's refreshing, it's lemony, but it's also got that cumin all the way through it. It was completely amazing when I tried it, and I've struggled to find it ever since. And
Never had anything that tastes like this in drink form.
No, that is unique. It's like drinking the base of a curry or a chili con carne.
But no, it's not spicy.
No.
No, no, no.
No, no, but it's just the flavour is what you associate with cooking.
Yeah, I can't get my head around it. I think I like it, but I can't. There's nothing wrong with it.
Slightly carbonated, but not super fizzy.
No.
You know what, you know what it's like? It's like if you'd got a lemonade, and when you weren't looking, I just sprinkled some cumin into it.
Yeah.
So this particular one has got citric acid in it to give you that sort of citrus note, but it's not as lemony. A lot of them are classic, just lemon soda, added salt, sometimes black salt, and then cumin.
It's the salt and cumin combination that makes my brain go, why are you drinking this? You shouldn't be drinking
it. It's so good.
But then my tongue's telling me this really works, but yeah. My brain's like, it can't, mate. But my tongue's like, but it does, mate. And so I'm internally conflicted at the moment.
I like it.
I really like it.
Yeah, I can
and
tell.
I was so excited when we were going to do this because I remember coming back from India and forcing you to sit through learning about Indian breads.
Yeah.
I had in India. And I was desperately trying to find that drink at the time to bring to that table. And that was years ago.
Yeah.
And I'd kind of forgotten about it until we planned this.
That's what Willie Cooks would say. Knock, knock, cumin. That's great.
Yeah, nice.
Can you see yourself getting a six-pack for your next summer barbecue?
I'd buy a can to get other people to try it.
In the same way we just had a first experience of something.
Do you know what? I can
very different.
Absolutely see why you would drink this when it's hot and sweaty outside.
Yeah.
I can see you craving something like this and it just hitting the spot.
It's lifting my Christmas party fog from last night.
Is it? Yeah.
Yes.
If you think about any kind of recovery drink, it's giving you the electrolytes, the salts and the sugars your body needs. And you can do it just by, you know, getting a glass of water, a little bit of salt, a little bit of sugar, squeeze of lemon juice, and that is like a real, it gives your body back what it's missing. I'm not suggesting, because we should all be drinking responsibly, but the morning after a heavy night, I think this is also a great option. Boys, have you got a favourite of the four you've tried today?
Favourite dish was the quesadilla, that was amazing.
You like the smut?
Yeah, and I think of more places that I could use it. So that'd be my favourite.
I really like the fox nuts, the lotus seed popcorn. I thought that was great.
Mine's obviously the jeera soda, love it. But comment down below, which of those four would you most like to try if you haven't? And always keep commenting down below under every video of new stuff we should be trying.
Yeah, please do.
Please do.